And good morning, everyone. The schools in Tunisia, Laos, and our teachers from Lebanon. And I really appreciate Nikhil, Dianna coming over. Thank you so much for your time. So this is our second of our session that we are involved in our effort to get the students understand the issue of plastic pollution and starting on with how to look at addressing this issue, starting with the kitchen, especially where the single-use plastics are a big issue. So I would like to introduce Dianna. Dianna, you can go ahead and do a self-introduction, and then I would play the video, and then we get on with the presentation.
Great. So I guess good day, everybody, and good morning to some people, and good evening to others. I'm Dianna Cohen, and I'm a visual artist, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of Plastic Pollution Coalition. For those of you who speak French, bonjour, je m'appelle Dianna Cohen. Je suis le co-fondateur, or I don't know how you say that, de Plastic Pollution Coalition, and I'm based here in Los Angeles, California, and I'm sending everyone big hello and greetings. Plastic Pollution Coalition is a global alliance of more than 1,200 organizations, all working to stop plastic pollution and to raise awareness about the toxic impact on human health, animal health, the ocean and waterways, and the environment. And I'm very happy to be here.
Okay, thank you, Dianna, for your introduction. And I'm going to play this short video, the music, and then Dianna, the floor is all yours.
A big idea, something that would last for a million years. You see, someday we will all disappear, but the big idea will still be here. You got to use it again, baby. Don't you throw it away. Now, who can imagine everything it would bring? You can turn plastic into any old thing. It's so convenient, you just can't beat it. Till it gets in the ocean and the fish start to eat it, you got to use it again. Baby, don't you throw it away. When a turtle can't swim and a bird can't sing, when they're stuck in the hole of a six-pack ring, we got bottles and bags, caps and cups. We got too much stuff, we got to clean it all up. You got to use it again, baby, don't you throw it away. Well, the face of this planet, as far as I can see, well, it could use just a little plastic surgery. Starting to miss how it all turns out is anyone's guess. I use it all the time, I must confess. But if I care a little more, I'll use a little less. You got to use it again, baby. Don't you throw it away. 'Cause it's a beautiful world.
So thank you so much for having me. This is such a cool series, and I'm really honored to be here and to be able to have a conversation with all of you students in different parts of the world. I'm coming to you again from Los Angeles, California. I'm on the western coast of the United States of America. And I wanted to focus my presentation for you today on solutions to plastic pollution and to talk about it really from art to action and how I approach this issue as an artist and as a visual artist. So, let's see. Advance. I thought I'd share some of my artwork with you first, just to give you guys background of how I came to this issue. I grew up here in Southern California and I love the ocean. I love swimming and body surfing. When I was about 25, I became certified as a scuba diver. And around that same time of my early 20s, I started to make some collage-based work. I had studied painting in school at UCLA, University of California here in Los Angeles. I'd studied biology and art. And I started originally making work that was painting-based, oil paintings and watercolors, but I began to do some collage work and use bits and pieces of bags, paper bags originally. And then I started using plastic. And I found plastic to be quite an interesting material. And I would say at this point, I probably have a love-hate relationship with the material, but this is an earlier piece that I made. Originally, I would just deconstruct the bags, cut them along the seams. A lot of these circles and things that you see in this piece. This piece is called Rainbow Us, Rainbow US. And all of these different shapes are actually the handles from bags. So I just started deconstructing the bags. And again, originally I was working with brown paper bags and using paper bags, and then I began to incorporate plastic bags into my pieces. So it was very focused on like work that was kind of emballage du carton. It was cardboard and paper moving into plastic. And you can't see this close up, but if you could see this piece more closely, I use a needle and thread as a sewing device, kind of like a drawing tool in my work. So I combine all the bags together using a needle and thread as a sewing element. This is a piece called Recycle Man. And so when friends began to learn that I was making work out of plastic bags, not only did I begin to use the plastic bags that ended up in my life when I purchased something or bought something coming to me at a shop or a market, but I also began collecting them from friends, especially other friends who were artists or people who just wanted to clean out a closet or a drawer in their house and get rid of their plastic bags. So I started receiving packages from friends in different parts of the world that had, I'd open them up really excited and there would be maybe a post-it, maybe a note, maybe no note, and just folded up plastic bags. So this bag in particular was sent to me by some friends in Europe. And I thought it was so funny and so deeply ironic to print an image of a man who looks like he's excited about reusing some kind of reusable bag, but printed on a plastic bag. This was a piece I made called Wave Lens. The focus of this was going to be my flag that I was going to use when I wanted to go out to in the Pacific Ocean to the Great Pacific Garbage Patch and start harvesting all the plastic, which I imagined was floating on top, and bringing it back onto a ship or a cargo ship and chipping it up and cold molding it and making bricks out of it. This whole idea that I had before we created Plastic Pollution Coalition. So this was my flag for my expedition. And it was around the time that I made that piece. I made that piece probably right after I met Captain Charles Moore. And he looked at me and just said to me really straight, he said, "Let me just tell you something about the Great Pacific Garbage Patch and the plastic in the ocean." He said, Are you listening? "You can't clean it up." He said to me, "You can't clean it up." He's like, "We got to figure out how to stop it." And it was so interesting to have him say that. I told him, Stop saying that to people, to young people. A young person's going to come along and figure out how to clean it up. Stop saying that to us. But in a sense, after working on this for more than 10 years now, I really think he's probably right. I don't know that we're going to be able to clean it up, but it would be great if we could stop manufacturing, making, and using it the way that we're using it. So I think that is not sustainable at all, and we're poisoning ourselves. This is a newer piece that I made, and I have some grapevines growing outside the door of my studio, and every year I cut them back, and every year I wind them into different shapes, and this was a series that I made that I called lifesavers, basically, like life preservers, the kind of things that are on the side of boats that you throw to someone and they float. So that's what I was thinking about. I was also thinking about how much plastic I've been seeing that gets tangled around the roots of trees and mangrove forests, in the shoreline in different parts of the world. And I just, what I'm seeing, what happens with plastic, particularly plastic bags, when they get out into our environment. And I've seen it all over the world. I've seen it across the United States. I've seen it in North Africa and Morocco and Mali. I've seen it in South Africa. I've seen it in Southeast Asia. I've seen it in different parts of Europe and in Southern Spain, where they have a big agricultural community that's growing tomatoes, any kind of industrial agriculture. You'll see a lot of plastic bags get out into the environment, and they get tangled and intertwined in all of the organic natural stuff that's happening that breaks down at a much faster rate. So pretty toxic for our environment. I'll move more quickly because I have tons of slides, and I just wanted to really be able to show you guys not only my artwork, but also the artwork of other friends of mine and colleagues who are doing work to considering and thinking about plastic and thinking about this issue. This is a newer piece of mine as well. So I started making more freeform pieces. This is a long piece that I made that was called falda. Falda means skirt in Spanish. And it made me think of these long wedding skirts that flamenco dancers use, flamencas. It's a particular kind of dance that they do. And all of the bags that I used in this piece have text and images on them that refer to your home and where you live and your house. They say home, casa, home, the word home in different languages, maison. So that's what I was thinking about. I was really thinking about women and what it means to be a woman and to be maybe in many families, the primary decider of what is purchased in the house. This was a piece I made called Green. I also found a deep irony in the fact that on plastic bags, they print many, many images of plants and trees and flowers and animals and organic things. So this piece, if you could see it up close, it has a lot of images of plants in it. There's a deep irony in that for me, because when plastic bags became more popularized, particularly in the United States in the late 70s at the market, the idea was you would be offered paper or plastic. And many people took plastic rather than paper, because the marketing behind that was aimed at us as consumers was that you were saving a tree by choosing the plastic. So it's very clever marketing by the plastic industry. And of course, I never thought about what plastic was made out of. I mean, I just never thought about it. And I think many people still don't think about what it's made out of. When you ask them if they know what plastic is made out of, they say, oh, plastic, it's made out of plastic. You know, they don't know. These were some large scale pieces I made. This is a piece called Funnel. It's about 15 feet high, whatever that is. Is that 3 meters or anyway? You could walk inside of it though. It's pretty big. This was a piece I made called Bridge. It's about 25 feet long. So no, actually this one's 5 meters. The other one's like 3 meters high. This is a piece I made originally when I was traveling, and I made it in different components and folded it up in my bag and carried it with me. It's when you used to be able to carry big scissors with you on airplanes. I guess it was before 9/11 in the United States. This was an exhibit I was in Orange County at a museum there. This was a large scale piece I made called Ocean of Plastic. I made it with 200 kindergarten through fifth graders at the Benjamin Franklin International School in Barcelona, Spain, Catalonia, in 2010. And this piece has traveled around the world maybe more than I have, because it folds up into like a large FedEx box. So it's had a very exciting life traveling to Windhoek, Namibia, and all kinds of places I've actually never been for exhibits. And the kids made all the different components of it. So they made the octopus and the whales and the sharks and the starfish. And then I worked with some teachers and some parents who volunteered, and we spent about a month sewing it and combining it all together. That was a really fun project to do. I hope it'll give people some ideas of ways that you can use this material, make art out of it, and create communication and messaging to talk about the problem and the issue with others. This is a piece I made called Post-Consumer Mandala. I made it after I went to hear the Dalai Lama speak in Northern California. And I've presented it both in this way, hung like a flag or a banner, but I've also shown it hanging it vertically from those black handles on the side down. And when I show it in that way, you can see more clearly that there's kind of a mandala in the middle of it. So I'm going to skip through these pretty quickly. And if anyone has questions at the end, I'm happy to answer them, because I know that you got to hear Charlie Moore present to you already about the impact of what plastic is doing out in the world, and particularly in the ocean and our environment. But this is the gateway to an island called Kefalonia in Greece. It's the island my maternal grandfather was born on, and they have a big problem with plastic pollution. These are images different friends have sent me. This is from Croatia. These are images I took in Thessaloniki, in another part of Greece, northern Greece, right below Bulgaria, right before I gave a TEDx talk there about plastic pollution. I walked over to look over the edge of the road, and this is what I saw. I just like to include these images because I think it's important to realize that plastic pollution knows no boundaries, and it impacts us all over the world, no matter where we are. It's not the fault of any one country, but it definitely is enhanced or has expanded thanks to pretty much a small handful of big corporations and companies that package all of their products in it. I'm sure you saw this image when Charlie spoke about plastic that Marcus Ericsson found inside a fish that he caught and was cutting up to eat when he drift sailed on the junk raft from Long Beach, California to Hawaii. I'm gonna zip through some of these. That's an image I took in Indonesia a couple years ago. It's a lot of burning of plastic across the United States and in different parts of the world. Many times people call it waste energy or waste to fuel. They often call recycling, chemical recycling, or these different forms of supposed recycling, but many of them really are just ways of incineration. And when we burn plastic, we release dioxins and particulate pollution, and it's particularly toxic for people who live right near where that's happening, in fence line and frontline communities and indigenous communities and communities often of color. But it's also toxic for us all, because we all need clean air to breathe. So these are some pictures I took of these beautiful monkeys there that were eating plastic on the side of the road. This is an image a friend sent me from Bahia, Brazil. This is an image from Charlie and Algalita from the Big Island in Hawaii. Obviously, plastic production is increasing exponentially, and that's a big problem. I went to a shop yesterday, you guys, to look for something. Actually, earlier today, and I walked all the way around the whole store. I didn't find the thing I was looking for, but my observation was that almost everything in the entire shop was made out of plastic. It was like a home store where you could buy everything for the house. And if it wasn't made out of plastic, if it was made out of wood or bamboo or, you know, steel or glass or ceramic, some other material, most often it was packaged in plastic. I know Charlie spoke to you all about microplastics and nurdles and nanoplastics, so I'll just zip through these images. I like to include this image. My friend Greg Stone took it in Raja Ampat in the South Pacific because it always helps remind me that when I first began to learn about this problem, the more I learned, the more I realized that I wasn't just worried about plastic out in the ocean or these gyre systems of plastic. I was worried about, you know, the plastic in the market or in the shops and what we package all of our food and beverages in. And then the plastic in the refrigerator. When you get home and you're looking for something to eat or you go to prepare food, oftentimes you can buy it and it's packaged in plastic. And so that's a concern for me. And then I'm the most concerned about plastic, the chemicals in plastic that are used to make it, the plasticizing chemicals, which have been identified as endocrine disruptors. So for example, bisphenols like BPA and BPA substitutes and phthalates. Phthalates have also been dubbed or named obesogens because they make our bodies hold fat. So I'm really concerned about those. I'm gonna zip through these pictures. I feel like you've probably seen some of them already about pelagic seabirds like Laos and albatross eating plastic and then feeding it to their babies and their babies dying in situ with their stomachs full of plastic. The contents of one bird's stomach, that's an image that Susan Middleton took. But images that have also been shared with us from around the world, obviously sacred cows in India eating plastic on the side of the road and walking down the road, camels in the United Arab Emirates, eating plastic bags and garbage on the side of the road, same thing, dying with their whole stomach and rumen full of plastic. This is a sign I made with some friends a few years ago at a printing place with this old printing, you know, like an old printing press where you had the little metal plates and you took all the letters and you put them together and you clamped them together and then you put them on a press and inked it and rolled it, this whole machine that came down. It's pretty cool. I helped co-found Plastic Pollution Coalition. I run it and we're a global organization and our main focus is to encourage people to refuse single-use plastic.